Are you troubled by the fact that even since August 22nd, we've had a couple arguably smaller instances, but this is not a perfect system right now. Zero tolerance is something you and others at the SEC have talked about.
Well, I think our objective has to be zero tolerance. I think we all know that technology is never going to be perfect, which is why we also have to focus on what do you do when you do have an incident. I think we have the safest, most reliable markets in the world, but clearly anytime you have any kind of incident, really however big and whatever the cause is, and often it's not the same kind of cause. Like, for example, I think you saw some media reports after the August 22nd, you know, NASDAQ incident, you know, saying volume, high frequency traders. Well, that had nothing, whatever, you know, to do with that incident, but any incident can undermine investor confidence. So we really want that objective of zero tolerance to be achieved as closely as it possibly can.
Why isn't perfection a reasonable standard here? Yes, there's a lot of technology involved, but these are the most important markets in the world. A lot of money riding on some of these trades and issues. Why is it not good enough to expect even higher performance?
Well, I think we were expecting very high performance. I mean, I think we hold the bar very high, and we should hold it very high. Perfection, that's what we're seeking, but we have to be, you know, realistic and prepared to deal with the incidents that may well always occur to some degree, but we want to get as close as we can to zero incidents.
The exchanges as self-regulatory organizations themselves, is there going to be a larger conversation here about the future of the exchanges as SROs? Is it worth talking about a larger rulemaking, depending on what you hear in these reports back? Is there a larger discussion that needs to take place here?
Well, I think there needs to be a comprehensive discussion that takes place with every issue on the table. I mean, the SRO structure has served us very well. They're very important regulatory functions still done by the SROs. What we're doing right now in terms of the reports coming in today and dealing with the systems issues, the SROs are leading that effort, and they should be. But we want to look at every issue that impacts our market structure. One of those sets of issues is the role, the optimal role of the SROs and the exchanges.
A few others out there that you're dealing with, you've dealt with money markets to some extent, still waiting for a final rule on that. Give us a sense where you think that stands right now and the likelihood we might see changes from what you proposed originally.
Essentially, we proposed in June, if I'm remembering correctly, the money market fund reforms. Comments, I think, were in by mid-September. We're working very hard on those comments. As many will know, we essentially proposed alternatives which could be done separately or combined, one that would require a floating NAV of prime institutional funds, there's a retail exception to that, or a fees and gates approach as well. And so the comments have come in, we've gotten a lot of comments. Most of them, I can say, seem to be addressed to either the floating NAV is great or it's not great, you know, different views on that, that we've gotten comments as to whether we should exempt municipal money market funds as we have government funds. And we've gotten some comments on really both sides of the issue on whether we've struck the right spot for the retail exemption. And so, you know, I think we're moving that forward as quickly as we can. We want to take into account, you know, all of the comments that we're getting, and they're really quite constructive comments.
Madam Chairman, my name is John Taft with RBC Wealth Management. I thought you were going to answer a question about fiduciary standard, and I was looking forward to your answer with respect to Section 913 and then also the DOL's proposed expansion of fiduciary. What are your thoughts, your perspective, and your plans?
Sure, I'm happy to answer that. Essentially, under 913 of Dodd-Frank, the SEC was essentially given, you know, clear authority, not a mandate, but clear authority to impose a uniform fiduciary duty standard on broker-dealers and investment advisors. There's more language around it as well. There are also some clear guideposts, such as just because they're commissions doesn't mean that you've got. An inherent conflict of interest or violation of fiduciary duty. Just because they're principal transactions doesn't mean that you do. And so essentially, I think it's a very important area. And I say area because obviously it's a commission decision as to whether to do that in the first instance. It's a high priority for me to figure out where we are going with respect to that. I mean, you essentially have what prompts the issues, and they've been around for a while. But is that you've got brokers and investment advisors, particularly at the retail level, providing the same advice to retail customers. Retail customers are not entirely sure whether they're dealing with a broker-dealer under suitability standard or they're dealing with an investment advisor under fiduciary standard. So anytime you've got the same conduct, at least in part of what anyone does, regulated differently, you need to take a very close look at that and see what you should do about it. So it's something that is a high priority for me to figure out what we should do. But it is a question for the commission to decide, to decide that ultimately.
You got a timeline on that?
I don't have a timeline on that. I mean, I can say that I've directed, staff and resources to it. So I guess they would phrase it as one of the things, probably they'd say everything that I asked them about is lighting a fire under them. But I mean, I really want to get, have that have real traction so we can decide what to do in fairly short order. The Department of Labor, to answer the rest of your question, is obviously, also studying from their very different, from the ERISA perspective, what to do in their rulemaking. We're separate independent agencies. We obviously realize the concerns about consistency and also the impact that their rulemaking can have on the broker-dealer model, for example. We're in discussions, our staff has been for some time with their staffs, explaining to them from our expertise, our corner of expertise, what that model is, how the risks are safeguarded for under the current system and so forth. I've personally started engaging in that dialogue as well. That's about all I can say about it at this point.